It was on the morning of the 2nd of April 1982 that Argentine armed forces suddenly invaded a small group of remote islands in the South Atlantic. They were the Falkland Islands, to which Argentina, which knew the islands as the Malvinas, had held a long-standing claim. Now Argentina and her ruling military junta had decided to use force to seize control of the territory she believed was rightfully hers. The Argentine invasion came as a complete shock to Britain and to the islanders themselves. The political wrangling and posturing began almost immediately, but it soon became clear that no amount of talking would yield a political solution to the crisis.
The Argentinians had taken it by force, and we were damn sure we were going to go and take it back by force if that's what it took.
We were in an expeditionary force, long way from home, three-dimensional battle. It makes you realise exactly what warfare is about.
You've got to be meaner, badder, uglier, and you've just got to be more vicious than the person you're fighting. If you're not prepared to be more vicious, then you shouldn't be there. And if you can't be more vicious, you're going to lose.
Soldier screamed, a piercing scream, as if he had been stabbed. That's when we reacted. After that, it was all screams.
It was a case of march or die.
The decision to invade the Falkland Islands was not taken lightly, but it was made by a military regime desperate to gain popularity among the disillusioned Argentine people. After years of military rule, the economy of the country lay in virtual ruins, and the regime was discredited and unpopular. There was no better way to defuse a potentially explosive situation than to exploit the one issue that united the nation, the recovery of the Malvinas. So it was that on April the 2nd, 1982, more than 1,000 Argentine Marines and Special Forces troops landed on the Falkland Islands. After 3 hours of fighting, they overwhelmed the island's British garrison of only 80 Royal Marines, known as Naval Party 8901. The fighting reached its climax here, around Government House, and it soon became clear that the British garrison's position was hopeless. Acknowledging the grim reality of the situation, the governor of the islands ordered the British troops to surrender their arms.
Well, the mood and response in Britain as a whole at the time was one of very clear shock and disbelief and anger at this humiliation which had taken place, and the government was not surprisingly held responsible for having allowed it to happen. Its own reaction, therefore, was one of understandable embarrassment in the first instance, followed by a readiness to take action, both military and diplomatic, to try and rescue the situation.
I received a telephone call early in the morning from my boss, General Jeremy Moore, and he said, words to the effect of, you know those people down south, they are about to be invaded, you ought to bring your brigade to 72 hours notice, load and sail south. The first thought that went through my head as I sat on the side of my bed in the gloomy early morning was that all my staff, bar one guy, was sitting in Denmark planning an exercise while I was sitting in England, and I was going to be without their very necessary help and support until I could get them back.
The Argentines had gained control in spectacular fashion and claimed the Malvinas as their own. Meanwhile, nearly 1,400 kilometres to the east of the Falklands, there was further trouble on the island of South Georgia. There, a detachment of 9 Royal Marines from HMS Endurance came under fire. They too surrendered themselves. The first chapter in the story of the Falklands War was over, and while there were wild scenes of celebration in Argentina, news of the battles was relayed to a stunned United Kingdom. The British tabloid press went into a frenzy, and many Britons reached for an atlas in order to identify the islands that had brought their country and Argentina to war. With the Argentine forces firmly in position on the Falklands, the escalating dispute over the islands moved onto the world stage. On the 3rd of April 1982, the United Nations Security Council passed Resolution 502, calling for Argentina to withdraw her forces from the islands, was ignored.
The then First Sea Lord, Admiral Sir Henry Leach, had assured the Prime Minister that in terms of being able to make an effective response, he could have a task force ready, notice to sail within 48 hours. Authority was therefore duly given for that task force to assemble and to begin to sail from the following Monday morning of the 5th of April.
The original intent was to show that there was to be a reaction to the invasion on the Falklands, and it was to get ships down into the area.
We were actually literally teetering on the edge of not being physically able to do it, not because we weren't well trained and prepared, but because we didn't have enough amphibious kit, because it had been got rid of over the years.
The most recent defence review by British Defence Minister John Nott required that the British Royal Navy's role be focused primarily on anti-submarine work in the Cold War North Atlantic. The Falklands War changed all that forever.
Though the amphibious ships were going to remain temporarily, of course the carriers were going to be sold. And without the carriers, there would have been no air cover and therefore no amphibious operation. No question of retaking the Falkland Islands.
The crisis blew up. The battalion was in Chelsea Barracks doing public duties in London. Not really affiliated to any formation or any prospect of going into a major conflict. But that all changed fairly rapidly after the invasion. And we were attached quite quickly to 5 Brigade.
I was on the shooting range at Tidworth and was immediately called back to barracks where we were informed what was happening. And I was posted to C Company to take over a platoon, which was 7 platoon. The 3 para were the spearhead battalion. So at that point, we knew that we would be the first to go into any operation outside of the UK.
At the time, I was on a section commander's course, and we were doing the 2 weeks build-up for the course at our depot in Aldershot, and there were soldiers there from also 3 para. They were on spearhead at the time, and come Friday afternoon, we went downtown for a few beers, and all the 3 para guys that we were going to meet downtown weren't there. We wondered why they hadn't showed up, and then we found out afterwards, of course, that they'd been recalled to camp because of what had happened in the South Atlantic.
Just 3 days after the invasion, a British task force set sail from Portsmouth with the brief to return the Falklands to British control. At the heart of the task force were the aircraft carrier HMS Invincible and the venerable commando carrier HMS Hermes, a converted aircraft carrier. Aboard the assault ship HMS Fearless was the headquarters of 3 Commando Brigade. Sent with the task force for air defence and as close air support to ground troops was the Harrier jump jet. From a British perspective, it was perhaps most vital that the task force was seen to be going at all, for it signalled to the public and to the watching world Britain's determination to recover the islands, by force if necessary.
The nation were giving us one hell of a send-off, particularly as we left Southampton. My particular memory is of the blocks of flats that it was almost as if it was coordinated, but the lights were being switched on and off, going up and down the floors as we were going out, and that was very much like a ticker tape send-off. It was quite emotional at the time.
And it was very, very good for morale, and the sort of national fervour manifested itself, certainly in our case, and we had a terrific send-off. I mean, it was really like going to the Boer War or something like that. But that had a very, very good effect on people. And I think a lot of people didn't really appreciate what was actually involved.
We were faced with two things. One was that the brigade was getting bigger and bigger as more units were added to it. So as soon as we'd crammed the existing numbers into ships, we were then faced with cramming more in. And we didn't have enough shipping to begin with. And until shipping was requisitioned, like the liner Canberra, I simply couldn't see how we were going to get everybody down there.
I mean, it was quite an adventurous concept of operations to launch a task force that, in comparison to the sort of rapid reaction forces and things that are constituted nowadays, was pretty ad hoc. And to launch it that distance into that sort of environment, to a location where the enemy had much shorter lines of communications and could interdict our operations from the air, it was pretty adventurous.
Behind the waving Union flags, the bands playing Rule Britannia, and the ships full of troops waving goodbye to their loved ones, things were not as ordered as they seemed. Some military hardware was not even fully operational. HMS Invincible, for example, was sailing with only one of her two propellers working. The other had shattered a gear coupling just as she departed. The great British task force that sailed down the Solent was rather like a swan, moving effortlessly and serenely across the water while paddling furiously beneath the surface. Because of the speed at which the task force was assembled, a great deal of equipment had to be left behind, and much that had been taken aboard was in the wrong place on the wrong ship. Ships stationed at Gibraltar were, however, able to supply the force, and the volcanic South Atlantic island of Ascension, where the United States shared a base with Britain, became a vital air base and stopover point.
We were effectively doing our final preparations. As far as logistics were concerned, there was a lot of equipment that was packed on the wrong ships, and a lot of time was spent in cross-decking equipment and supplies.
There was enough time gap between departure from the UK and actually deploying into theatre to think through the concept. And actually, if you think about it in military terms, it's better to be planning when you know you've got the resources available than thinking they're, you know, 2 weeks away in a ship. And we had plenty to be getting on with in the interim, such as training and briefings, intelligence briefings, threat assessments, terrain studies, all that sort of stuff.
When we turned up at Ascension, I got up in the morning. It was dark when we arrived there. In the morning I got up and there were just ships everywhere. It was quite impressive actually to see it, and I thought, yeah. We did feel invincible when we saw all the backup that we had, and we knew that somewhere in the distance were the carriers as well, with the Harriers. We felt that you know, we were a pretty strong force, and we felt very confident.
The passage to the South Atlantic took us in the order of 3 weeks. Not many of us had ever spent time in the Southern Oceans or the South Atlantic before. We were going into an area where we were clear that an invasion on a protectorate of Britain had happened, and we were going there to stop anything further happening.
Ahead lay a foe in waiting, and an uncertain future. Before the Falklands could be liberated, the task force first had to retake South Georgia. The highly professional SAS and SBS, supported by Royal Marines from M2 Commando, were ordered into battle and were given until the end of April to free South Georgia. The weather was atrocious, and the terrain over which the troops would have to fight, especially the infamous Fortuna Glacier, meant that it would be a difficult and dangerous operation. the Argentines had also reinforced their garrison on South Georgia with 40 Marines carried on board the submarine Santa Fe. In fact, the presence of the Santa Fe in the area had already caused some concern among the British task force, which was now approaching South Georgia. On Sunday the 25th of April, the Santa Fe was spotted on the surface, where two WASP helicopters immediately attacked her. Badly damaged, the Santa Fe limped into Grytviken Harbour on South Georgia, where she was promptly attacked once again by HMS Antrim's Wessex helicopter. At the same time, in appalling weather conditions, the British landed an assault force of Special Forces troops, reinforced by M Company of 42 Commando on the island. Within a short time, a firepower demonstration by the guns of HMS Antrim and HMS Plymouth had persuaded the Argentine garrison to surrender. A relieved Downing Street at last had some good news to report.
Ladies and gentlemen, the Secretary of State for Defence has just come over to give me some very good news, and I think you'd like to have it at once.
The message we've got is that British troops landed on South Georgia this afternoon, shortly after 4 p.m. London time. They have now successfully taken control of Grytviken. At about 6 p.m. London time, the white flag was hoisted in Grytviken beside the Argentine flag, and shortly afterwards the Argentine forces there surrendered to British forces. The commander of the operation has sent the following message. Be pleased to inform Her Majesty that the White Ensign flies alongside the Union Jack in South Georgia. God save the Queen.
What happens next? What's it?
Thank you very much.
Just what's your reaction?
Rejoice at that news and congratulate our forces and the Marines.
Are we going
good
to
night,
declare
gentlemen.
War on Argentina, Mr. Thatcher? Much.
The recapture of South Georgia may not have been a major event from a purely military perspective. However, it was a very important victory for the British forces, which now had shown the world that they could fight and win against the Argentines, a fact not lost on the Argentines themselves.
I was always convinced we were going to get involved in a land battle, because you don't invade a country and then suddenly decide to pack up and go home. So I was pretty convinced that we were going to have to kick them out.
My brigade was spread across something like 12 ships. So I used to go by helicopter and visit and see how everyone was getting on and chat to my commanding officers, the company commanders, talk to the troops as I wandered around as they were doing their training and fitness training, because I wanted to see how they were doing. I wanted to get from them how they felt. And it was important that they saw me and knew that I was around as their commander.
We had a fairly intensive period of training, and I felt that we were ready to go to war at that stage, given the level of opposition, which we assessed, as far as I remember, as being, and I think we were quite cocky, as not being very high. However, when we actually got to grips with the Argentinians, particularly the ones that we fought, they were probably better than we expected.
The air war on the Falklands began on the 1st of May 1982, when the RAF mounted a bombing raid in an operation codenamed Black Buck. A Vulcan bomber, flying all the way from Ascension and refueled in the air by Victor tankers, dropped 21,000-pound bombs onto the airfield at Stanley, the capital of the Falkland Islands. Although only one of the bombs landed on the runway itself, the raids again demonstrated to the Argentines and the islanders that Britain was willing and able to attack her enemy anywhere on the Falklands.
The feeling was that probably it did more damage to the Argentine morale than anything else. So I think it was worthwhile just to prove to them that we could do this. You know, we could fly from the UK and still bomb you. And if we can bomb Port Stanley Airfield, we can bomb Buenos Aires if we have to. So that was my own feeling at the time. So I was quite pleased that they went to all that effort to do it. It may not have been effective in tactical terms, but strategically and morally, I thought it was a good thing to do.
Just hours after the Vulcan bomber strikes on Stanley, there were more attacks on the airfield by Sea Harriers launched from the task force. This was the first action any British airman had seen for many years.
As we crested over the ridge to run into the airfield, there was a complete blanket of exploding AAA shells at a couple hundred feet, and a lot of visually laid AAA actually firing at us on the run-in. We all knew what we had to do, we knew which routes we were taking, and it was just a question of getting as low as you could, weaving around what flank you could, and putting weapons on. My first bomb probably took out an aircraft which was on the northern side of the airfield, which was a little light aircraft, and then the remaining two rolled across the airfield into the pan, which was actually full of smoke and flames already at this stage. The airport buildings were just a very large area of fire and smoke and dust. You couldn't actually pick out very little detail in there because there was so much.
But the following day, the 2nd of May, the Harriers were forced to switch their role from attack aircraft to air defence fighter for the protection of the fleet. Argentina launched a series of air attacks against the task force, most of which were intercepted by the Harriers, who attacked the Argentine Mirage jets with both cannon and Sidewinder missiles, the first time a Sidewinder had been fired in combat. These missiles proved extremely effective, and at about 7:15 p.m., Flight Lieutenant Paul Barton destroyed a Mirage jet, scoring the first British air-to-air combat success since the conflicts in Korea and Suez. The Harrier had supreme maneuverability in battle, thanks to the vectored thrust from its Pegasus engine, and the Harrier pilot could perform moves that were simply beyond the scope of conventional aircraft.
It would have been nice to have had a few more, but I'd have preferred it if we'd had the Ark Royal, the old Ark Royal, with some Phantoms and Buccaneers, and the airborne early warning aircraft as well. But then again, if we'd had the old Ark Royal and all those aircraft, I don't think the Argentinians would have invaded in the first place.
The fighting did not always go in favour of the British, however. On the 4th of May, the first Harrier was shot down by ground fire while attacking Goose Green, and its pilot, Lieutenant Commander Nick Taylor, was killed.
The fact that we were taking casualties, and I say we, not the battalion, but the task force, probably had an effect on increasing our determination to get to grips with the Argentinians. And it didn't, the morale didn't suffer on that score. I think what it did was wake people up to the fact this was a real war, and that it was a very serious business, and there was potential for people to be wounded and killed, and therefore it sharpened people up considerably.
The aged Argentine cruiser, General Belgrano, had set sail for the Falklands on the 26th of April, in the company of two Exocet armed destroyers. And by the 2nd of May, she was within 30 miles of the 200-mile exclusion zone that had been declared by the British around the islands. She was considered to be a threat to the task force, and after consultation with the British War Cabinet at Chequers, the submarine Conqueror was ordered to attack. This was to be one of the most controversial episodes of the entire Falklands War.
Conqueror was trailing Belgrano. She was coming in to the exclusion zone and was given the order that she was to be hit. And she carries a sophisticated range of weaponry, torpedoes, to do the job she is designed to do. And it was Mark 8s that she fired at the Belgrano.
At the time of her sinking, on the 2nd of May, she was outside the total exclusion zone, and her course was taking her, on the face of it, back to port and away from the islands.
A very young officer said he thought there were aircraft attacks. An NCO said he was confident it was a torpedo, and that we should stay still because shortly another one was going to hit us. I know of mates who saw a fireball and felt heat coming towards them as they were going to the canteen. That burnt a lot of people.
Within 10 minutes of the attack, the ship was flooding and listing 15 degrees. The Conqueror's second torpedo had killed or trapped some 250 Argentine seamen, either in their quarters or in the ship's galley. 20 minutes after the attack began, the Belgrano's captain, Hegonzo, gave the order to abandon ship.
There were crewmen that spent 48 hours adrift. Being next to one another gives warmth. We even urinated on ourselves to get heat from it. Everyone prayed and tried to keep awake. And that was imperative because death by cold is produced by a tiredness similar to not having slept for days.
The majority of the crew managed to scramble into life rafts, which afforded some protection from the huge 6-meter waves of the South Atlantic that were being whipped up by 90 kilometer an hour winds. But at 5 p.m., the General Belgrano finally rolled over and sank. Some 350 Argentine sailors lost their lives that evening, and the Argentine Navy was, with one deadly stroke, put out of the war.
The Belgrado, the Argentinian cruiser, has been torpedoed to the south of the Falkland Islands by one of our SSNs.
That was first shot in anger, and from a military perspective, a very successful thing to have happened, because it meant that all the Argentine naval units turned and went back to their ports and didn't come any further, and indeed never came out of their ports for the rest of the action.
My reaction was good. That's one out of the way. I mean, I don't mean that I sort of cheered and opened a bottle of champagne or anything like that. What I meant was we knew we were going to have to go down there and fight. A major piece had been removed from the board, a threat to the amphibious ships in which we were going to travel down there had been removed.
In Argentina, news of the sinking of the Belgrano was received with anger and disbelief. Amid the outpourings of patriotic fervor, there was a demand for revenge. Revenge for the sinking of the General Belgrano was not long in coming. On the 4th of May, an Argentine Super Etendard aircraft carrying one Exocet missile attacked the Type 42 destroyer HMS Sheffield, known throughout the British Navy as the Shiny Chef, which was commanded by Captain Sam Salt. The 164-kilogram warhead did not explode inside the Sheffield, but the impact of the missile and the incendiary effect of the rocket motor and its fuel caused terrible casualties and damage.
I can tell you that we're talking about seconds to react rather than minutes. And I'm sure you will appreciate that a missile which comes in less than 12 feet off the deck at very high speed, many hundreds of miles an hour, gives us a very short time of response. And we saw it at a stage at which there was really no time to do anything other than to say take cover. My overriding impression throughout the 5 hours that we tried to fight this damage was of immense calm, common sense, and careful thinking by really every member of the ship's company. I think we started thinking that we were on a losing wicket when we realized the fire was spreading. Decks were hot on the upper deck. You could feel the heat of the deck through your feet with shoes on. The superstructure was steaming. Paint on the ship's side is coming off. The area around where the missile penetrated the hull was glowing red. It was white hot and red hot.
We all had a lot of friends in our sister ships in the squadron, so once something like that had happened, you immediately start to think of, oh, who's been killed, who's injured, you know, is so-and-so all right? And it is a very worrying time. And very difficult to dispel. You've got to get around your team, tell them we're now into a circumstance that this is not an exercise, this is the real thing.
The 164-kilogram warhead did not explode inside the Sheffield, but the impact of the missile and the incendiary effect of the rocket motor and its fuel caused terrible casualties and damage. Never were the effects of naval economies more painfully felt. Many rules that had been an article of faith to the Royal Navy over many years have been recently changed to save money. Cheaper and more combustible materials, for instance, had been used in construction, while the Navy's No. 8 action working dress was now made of highly flammable polyester for economy and durability. There can be little doubt that some of the shocking burn injuries suffered by those aboard the Sheffield were directly attributable, at least in part, to cost-cutting in the Royal Navy.
I think actually we were very badly equipped to go into that sort of environment, and I think it was only the determination of the and the training of the soldiers that got people through it. And afterwards there was a very extensive analysis of certainly infantry equipment and clothing, and that I think was the start point, the catalyst for a massive improvement in field equipment generally.
Sheffield, I have to say, caused us to take a very long, hard look at ourselves. We suddenly realised that here we have this capable warships designed for this sort of thing, and it got caught. And by her being caught, we all got caught. It was something we didn't expect, and the feeling you get when a ship goes like that is one of real deep depression, because you suddenly feel, well, this could have been me, and quite clearly it could have been, particularly for us in Coventry, because we'd been on her station 6 hours before.
For everyone involved or on the sidelines, the operation to retake the Falklands had suddenly become a very serious business indeed. 20 British sailors had died, and the nation had seen the burning hulk of the Sheffield and the shocked and bloodied faces of the survivors as they climbed aboard the Hermes. This was no longer sabre-rattling with a foe that had been portrayed as a comic foreign junta. This was real war, and more men from both sides were going to die before it would be over. From early May, British Special Forces patrols were at work in a strategic reconnaissance role on the Falkland Islands. They were able to relay to the task force the worrying information that there were a number of Argentine ground attack Pucara aircraft on the islands. These posed a threat not only to the British ships that would support the landing, but also to the troops that would be required to advance across open land in order to attack Argentine positions. Armed with this new intelligence information, it was clear to the British that action would have to be taken to reduce the danger to the landing forces. It was therefore decided that the SAS would begin to destroy the Argentine Air Force on the ground. This dangerous work began on the night of the 14th and 15th of May, when a group of some 50 SAS soldiers from D Squadron 22 SAS, together with a naval gunfire observation team, were landed by Sea King helicopters on Pebble Island, the main Pucara base near West Falkland. The bold attack was a resounding success. The British troops, supported by 4.5-inch shells from HMS Glamorgan, took the Argentines completely by surprise and destroyed 11 aircraft. Their mission accomplished, the British soldiers tried to rejoin the helicopters, but they were attacked by Argentine troops and a fierce gun battle began. The assault force returned to the landing zone for pickup shortly after dawn, and it was flown back to the task force. Just two men had sustained only minor wounds during a highly successful operation. Planning for the full-scale attack on the Falkland Islands was moving apace.
Sancor's Water offered us a place where we could unload day or night, whatever the weather was. It was easily defended from the land. It was easily defended from the sea. Submarines couldn't get in there very easily. It was actually quite difficult to attack from the air, though not impossible. And it was far enough away from the main enemy concentrations for them not to be able to shell us while we were landing. So we should have a trouble-free landing without interference from enemy ground forces.
The plan was that 3 Commando Brigade would land first, along with the 2 parachute battalions and the 3 commando units. The Scimitar and Scorpion light tanks of the Blues and Royals, and the 105mm guns of 29 Commando Regiment, the Royal Artillery, would support these.
Well, we knew that we were going to carry out an amphibious landing at some stage, that was obvious. We didn't have any details of the actual mission until, you know, probably about 24 hours before we landed.
Major General Jeremy Moore of the Royal Marines was to be the eventual land commander, with Brigadier Julian Thompson commanding the immediate force of 3 Commando Brigade Royal Marines and Admiral Sandy Woodward, the carrier battle group. In overall command of the task force was the Commodore-in-Chief of the Fleet, Admiral Sir John Fielding, at his headquarters in Northwood, West London. On the evening of the 20th of May, the invasion fleet steered towards Falkland Sound and San Carlos. The night was crystal clear.
The plan was that we would land in 4 landing craft at Blue Beach 2, San Carlos Settlement, just ahead of one of the commando battalions that were landing at Blue Beach 1. But the marine crew that were handling the landing craft were having all sorts of problems, and we didn't end up landing together. And it was pretty cold, and we were sat in there for quite some time. And when we actually approached the beach to land, the ramp went down, and somebody who commanded the boat shouted, I think it was out troops, which is probably the command that goes to the Marines when they do their amphibious landings, but no one had briefed us on this. Nobody moved, and that's probably also because there was still a fair bit of water in front of us. And after a few attempts at trying to get us out with the command out troops, then someone shouted go, and we all understand the word go in the parachute regiment, and we started plopping off over the edge of the ramp, straight up to our waist. Well, to most guys, they were up to their waist in water. I was up to my chest, and only 5 foot from. It was a bit cold.
The second wave of landing craft arrived after daybreak, and as soon as daylight allowed, helicopters flew continuously back and forth, bringing men and supplies ashore.
We were on one of the larger landing craft and steaming towards shore when suddenly we came to a grinding halt about 200 or 300 meters offshore. And a little man in the front of the boat with a big pole said, "We've gone aground, sir." So we then stuck 300 metres off, which wasn't actually a very good feeling. And then we had to cross deck to smaller landing craft to get us on shore, which was not very impressive.
The first impression was the fact that they had this huge tussock grass. And we were carrying Bergens, and the difficulty of actually marching across this tussock grass. People were falling all over the place, and it was difficult.
We were carrying such heavy loads that if you fell over, you had to lie there like a turtle on your back with your arms and legs up, waiting for someone to come and pull you by the arms and pick you up, because your kit was just too heavy to pick yourself up.
Once we'd moved away from the foreshore, we moved up onto high ground, and the plan was to adopt a reverse slope defensive position where we dug in and waited. We were basically waiting for a response from the Argentinians, and it came very quickly.
Sure enough, the Argentine response soon came in a series of air attacks on the ships in the Sound, the first of which was made by a Pucara on HMS Argonaut. It missed its target and made its escape chased by anti-aircraft fire. But this was only the first of a devastating series of attacks pressed home by the brave and determined airmen of Argentina's Air Force.
I remember one particular case where a Skyhawk aircraft came over our position, and I was directing fire and through my binoculars could actually see the pilot looking back at me. Or back at us, and it was an interesting experience to see someone looking at you as the platoon that you're commanding is trying to take it down.
one thing that was amazing was the bravery of the Argentinian pilots going down there, and the skill of those pilots as well. And dodging missiles and flying low, and the way they just kept going in, even though they're getting blown out of the sky.
We then watched the task force being hit time and time again by Skyhawks and Mirage jets from the Argentinian Air Force.
The day wore on, and the intensity of the Argentine air attacks increased. HMS Ardent was in position south of the majority of the ships, ordered to provide naval gunfire support and act as a screen against air attack. This meant acting as a virtual decoy, and as Ardent moved to the centre of the sound in order to split the Argentine air attack, disaster struck. She was hit by more than 10 bombs. As dusk arrived, the full extent of the damage to HMS Ardent was all too clear. The ship was completely ablaze. Most of her weapons were out of action, and 22 members of her crew were dead. With a heavy heart, Ardent's captain, Commander Alan West, gave the order to abandon the ship. The stricken hulk of Ardent continued to burn into the night, but she would not be the last of the British losses. During the next few days, further terrible damage was inflicted on the British fleet. On Monday the 24th of May, HMS Antelope sunk after two 500-pound bombs crashed into her. The Merchant Navy lost the Atlantic Conveyor, a roll-off container ship she'd been requisitioned in Liverpool to carry most of the task force's helicopters and some extra Harrier jets. And on the 25th of May, Argentina's National Day, HMS Coventry was also sunk.
We were attacked by four Skyhawks with 1,000-pound bombs. They all went off, massive explosions within the ship. The first bomb exploded just below us in the ops room and took out the computer room, so that generally wiped out all my weapon systems. The fireball came out and took out the ops room, so we were all engulfed with fireballs, I was hurled out of my seat, knocked out, and that was it. I then come to, I don't know how long later, with the ship at a crazy angle, lots of little fires all around you, cabling going up in flames, injured men screaming. I helped beat open the door, which we managed to do, and get them all out into the open air.
The first real objective for the British land forces was the capture of Goose Green. The mission was given to Tupara, who were under the command of Lieutenant Colonel H. Jones.
At some stage we knew that we had to attack the Argentines. Someone had decided that Goose Green was going to be the first position that was going to be attacked. Tupara were closest to Goose Green, so that's probably why the brigade commander sent Tupara.
The brigadier was confident that with the forces at his disposal, he could keep his flank secure and concentrate, as he saw it, on the principal effort of building up the beachhead and preparing operations to break out and advance towards the main objective, which at the end of the day was Stanley.
In fact, it was a harder task than I thought it was, and I made a number of errors. I should have sent more troops down, I should have sent armour down there, and I should have commanded in person. I didn't give it the attention it deserved, because my eye was fixed in the other direction, which was advancing towards Mount Kent.
At 2:30 a.m. on the 28th of May, Tupara began its attack upon the Argentine positions, supported by shell fire from HMS Arrow. A Company was ordered to secure Burnside House, while B Company were to clear the high ground to the west. D Company, under Major Phil Neem, would then pass through and continue the advance.
My brother, Jim, was a section commander in A Company, and when A Company moved off the start line, there was a lot of tracer fire crisscrossing both directions, red tracer, green tracer. So I can see a lot of Argentine fire going back in the direction of A Company. And I remember being more worried for my brother than I was for myself at that particular time. But then it was our turn to get up and start our assault. We knew the enemy wasn't far from us. It was just a case of advanced contact from the start line. So on the signal, we got up and started walking towards the enemy.
The best thing we could do is fight at night, use the chaos of night to our advantage, because we were better trained than they were, and cut down casualties thereby.
It took a little while before that first contact. One of the forward sections had spotted an Argentinian standing up in his trench, and then all hell broke loose, and then became quite a confusing and frightening firefight, which lasted quite a long time.
As A Company slowly fought its way forward, Tupara's commanding officer arrived on the scene. Frustrated by the dogged Argentine resistance, Lieutenant Colonel Jones had also become extremely concerned at A Company's increasingly exposed and vulnerable position. Ammunition began to run low, and the loss of HMS Arrow's covering gunfire because of a jammed gun only added to Jones's anxiety. Furthermore, daylight was fast approaching. With British plans in disarray and morale running low, the next few hours were to have critical consequences for the outcome of the Falklands conflict.